Amongst these rather wooden performances on the sands of Jamaica, HTV's Dirty Tricks department is hatching a dastardly plot.
This is the kind of stunt where it would be much easier to be at home in the studios, because working on a beach in Jamaica with an explosion and all the variables of a stunt is kind of special effects job. One is sometimes grateful for the resources of home, because if it goes wrong, I think take two will probably be in the Bristol Channel.
Four cameras are trained on two dummies. They're about to meet a grisly end.
Jump out the water, and we want everything else to go a little bit higher. We don't want it too high. We don't want it too high. It should be absolutely right. It will be absolutely right.
We're rolling.
Luckily, we didn't burn all our boats. This one-time Danish cargo vessel became for us the good ship Saracen when we embarked on a voyage of high adventure for our 10-part series, Return to Treasure Island. Packed with action and set in exotic locations, it's a story written and developed very much in the style of Robert Louis Stevenson's original bestseller.
His classic tale of piracy on the Spanish Main has delighted and intrigued his readers for a century or more. Generations of boys and girls have sat enthralled from the very first page as young Jim Hawkins describes the sinister arrivals at the Admiral Benbow Inn, Billy Bones, Black Dog, Blind Pew, but it's Long John Silver who steals the show. He is wily, ruthless, yet curiously lovable. And when the Hispaniola sets out in search of buried treasure, it is Silver who masterminds the mutiny against Captain Smollett. On the last page, it all ends happily ever after. And yet not all of the treasure has been found. And John Silver is still at large. HTV's production picks up where Stevenson left off. It's 10 years later. Jim Hawkins has used his share of the treasure to pay for a university education. He's just come down from Oxford, uncertain about his future.
Brother? Ben?
Stormy seas are pounding away at the rocks beneath the Admiral Benbow, and a rowing boat is driven helplessly towards them. In the boat is a one-legged man. After 10 years of hardship and adventure on the high seas, Long John Silver has come home. On this eventful night, Jim is to meet all his old shipmates. Dr. Livesey, Captain Smollett, and Squire Trelawney.
Captain Smollett.
Look at the boy. You'd think he'd seen a ghost. It was the doctor's notion, Hawkins, and a capital fine one. Jim Hawkins is coming home from Oxford, says the doctor. Let's muster the whole ship's company of the Hispaniola to welcome him.
There's one more surprise castaway.
Ben Gunn.
Ah, that was my little joke, what?
And like most of you.
But in HTV's new series, there are new faces as well. Isabella, the proud and aristocratic Spanish beauty. The enchanting Conchita, a Mexican half-caste. Abed, a young slave who befriends Jim. The giant Van der Brecken, a Dutch planter. The sadistic Gafia, and the corrupt Hallows. It's to expose Hallows' fraudulent activities in Jamaica that Jim sets sail on the Saracen for the West Indies. So the story unfolds. An army of actors and technicians are on the move, traveling vast distances to tell the story written by John Goldsmith.
Because Stevenson was a very clever fellow. I mean, if he'd lived longer, he would undoubtedly have written his own sequel, because he left a row of dots. at the end of Treasure Island. I mean, he knew he'd got a winner in Long John Silver. I mean, Long John has hobbled through everybody's consciousness for a century and more.
Hey, that! Hold hard! Now listen to me, Bates! I'm taking this ship! For every man much against me, there's a boat and water and victuals! For every man much with me, there's a swift cruise and a fortune at the end of it!
Or a knife in the back, more like.
Jim Hawkins is played by Christopher Gard, and Brian Blessed is Long John Silver.
And Long John Silver is hopelessly attractive, really. He's the devil who hath power to assume a pleasing shape. But he's also someone who rescues Jim from death, keeps a constant eye on him. So he's personally very grateful to him, beholden to him, regardless of what he may have done, an extremely vicious nature to other people who've crossed paths with him.
Deadlock, Jim. I got the captain.
You got the cannon.
And the water. And the food supplies. And we outnumber you 2-1.
Aye. But then one of mine's worth 4 of yourn if it comes to a fight.
Well, we've no intention of fighting. We can afford to wait.
That's a dangerous game, Jim Wayne.
There must always be a mystery about Long John Silver. He's, as I said, he has a great love of life. A love for Jim. But he's a killer. I don't think he's a murderer.
Listen to me, Jim. I've a fondness for you. More than any other living being, save one who goes by the name of John Silver. Stand against me, and by the powers, I'll cut you down.
As Long John Silver's mutiny continues, the Saracen heads west across the Grey Atlantic. For HTV's cast and crew, it meant exchanging their Cardiff location for the rather different Caribbean. 55 miles of film were shot, 87 actors and 3,000 extras took part. All the paraphernalia of a major film unit were transported 19,000 miles, first to the Paradise Island of Jamaica. Directing the series was Piers Haggard.
Although this is a romantic action-adventure, it is written with a lot of insight. And I can't really imagine a better conceived or better written romantic adventure story. It, unfortunately, it's something that's gone out of fashion, rather.
Fights are meticulously planned. An injury to a lead actor out here could torpedo our budget.
Now, spread your arms. What? Now, here you go. Okay,
the fight choreographer is Alf Joint, stunt arranger for all the Bond movies.
I pride myself that if you take pains and you rehearse things and you work it all out in your head beforehand, then the chances of anything going wrong become very slight. If you work out a move, and if you think the move is a little bit dangerous for the actor, you change the move. Because if they get cut or damaged or hurt in any way, then the film stops and you're not very popular.
But it's Brian Blessed who bears the brunt of the physical action. When the camera rolls, he won't have the luxury of fighting on two legs, nor the support of his crutch, because in Alf Joint's scheme of things, that crutch becomes a lethal weapon. We used up no less than 12 of them during the filming.
When he fights, and he must be a very, very dangerous fighter. He is the most dangerous pirate of all. He's a very dangerous person. But he's got a great love for life, but he obeys no law at all.
Action!
Some of it is torture. It's not so much your one leg that is up. That doesn't hurt. It's the leg you're on. I find that I hop a great deal. I use the crutch to balance and hop. So I've worked very hard on this leg. I've been bench pressing 300 pounds in weights on my leg to give it great power. since I don't want him to be slow.
And
action.
I suppose it was the variety of physical activities, and fighting and riding, running, swimming, all the rest of it. And the frequency with which you have to do all those things, which required you really just to be generally very much on your toes. I mean, early nights are pretty important. All those boring sort of things, you know. It's just living for the work, really. Well, we were warned before we came out here that it was going to be tough, particularly for the leading characters.
I've been waiting for this, Hawkins.
The actual death-defying leap is made by look-alike stuntman Nick Hobbs.
It's very tiring, day in, day out, having to invent, create sequences and situations that will be exciting to people. And I've never, ever filmed for this length of time, and it'll be between 20 and 21 weeks by the time we've finished. And to go on doing good stuff 6 days a week for 20 weeks, and the seventh day one's also working anyway, is very draining.
A director just can't lose his cool. When the light is fading, the tide rising, and the horses don't get up enough steam, he must just persevere.
The other thing is, if we can clear some of this enormous caravan out of the way, then the horses might run faster and closer to the camera. Much faster, so that they need a much longer run up, okay?
We do get tired, people get tired, and keeping the standard up just means it's the very, very highest test of professional skill and endurance.
Further away,
okay.
They were too near.
Okay, here we go, and turn over, please.
Quick! Push! Come on, Ben!
And when the posse finally is in the can, there's still the getaway boat to film against a darkening sky. The trouble is, 100 yards out at sea, the actors can't hear an anguished director pointing them towards the setting sun.
Together, more towards the sun, towards the rock. Other way, towards the sun.
The boat leaks, the light fades. It's the end of another perfect day. After 3 months in Jamaica, the HTV circus moves off to the next location, Mexico, which turned out, in fact, to be southern Spain, and the famous old port of Almeria. 50 kilometers inland is the towering terraced crag of Rude Alquitea, a disused gold mine. This will serve as a quarry for slave laborers. It is a parched and arid zone. Everything, including water, is brought in at dawn and taken back to the hotel at dusk. Every day, 50 Spanish extras must be got up to look like convicts in a labor camp. To get them all on set on time in a suitably filthy state is hard enough, but there's the language problem as well.
No comprendo.
The makeup and wardrobe girls probably work the longest hours of all. As well as tousling hair and dirtying limbs, they must, at the end of each day's shooting, bundle up the dirty costumes and take them back to the hotel to be washed and dried overnight. At 7 o'clock every morning before the rest of the crew arrives, a curious ritual takes place on the set. The costumes, which have been so lovingly laundered to remove perspiration, are, as they say in the trade, dirtied down again. for slave labourers must look like slave labourers, not spick and span Spaniards.
Turn over, please. He's got a question.
There is a running buffet from 7 in the morning throughout the day and a limitless supply of non-alcoholic drinks. But the main meal is lunch, prepared for 300 people with a choice of three main courses.
Any sweet?
Oh, yeah.
Fruit is bought locally, but British crews like British food, and practically everything else has been driven all the way across Europe from a catering company in Leeds. At another location nearby, an eerie Mexican village set has been created. It's here that Alex Kirby is directing the second unit. An important sequence featuring the giant Van der Brecken, played by seven-footer Rainer Schoen.
Up there, across the street. This is the tavern.
Yes.
Okay.
I see.
Very suspicious now. Very suspicious. Yeah, they've gone out.
Door's half open.
Door's half open. It'll be a little more sharp than that. And here you go.
To create atmosphere in the sinisterly silent set, tumbleweed is released into the wind. And to add a helping hand to nature, a swirl of dust is made to blow across Van der Brecken's boots. Away from the Mexican village, Pierce Haggard and the main unit are preparing to shoot a scene in the El Condor Fort, constructed in the Foreign Legion style of architecture. Long John Silver is once more in the clutches of his enemies. Once more, he'll make his dash for freedom. It is not a shot they will want to take over and over again.
Just to confirm with Benito that he comes as fast as he possibly can.
Okay. Bueno.
And tilt. Turn in, towers. Tilt down. Go with the cart. Don't tilt too low because flare. I'll do the sky, Tony. It's a lovely parapet there which gives you shape.
Okay, here we go. All set inside?
There are almost 300 people hard at work on this project. Some of them rake stones and sharp objects off the ground, where actors have to fall.
You know when you roll down a bank when you're a kid? You've got to throw yourself, that's all. And it's an action where...
Producer Alan Clayton is on hand to give good advice on how to make a screen fight look convincing.
As soon as you start to do that, I'll cut.
There are two camera teams shooting simultaneously and two sound units. And there are people helping to ensure that the actors don't scrape their elbows or cut their knees.
That's under your shirt, isn't it?
Happy. Action. Cut. 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 Action, Chris.
Whatever precautions you take, it's far too risky to allow lead actors to do anything more than top and tail the most dangerous scenes. Once again, the stuntmen stand in when there's real danger to life and limb. Back in the cutting room, the film editor will make sense of all this, cutting in the close-ups of the leading actors to make it seem as if they are carrying all of the action, and making sure that none of the mistakes ever get shown.
Okay. 86, 5, 6, 7.
Every film has its moments of hilarity, and John Silver's return to Treasure Island had its own little treasure chest of moments when things did not go according to plan.
1, 2, 3, 2.
You know what Judas did? I suggest you do the same.
Stop! Stop! Whoa! Whoa! Come back! Whoa! Whoa! Action!
Whoa! By the powers!
A65, take 14.
It's sort of epic, really. It's a romantic epic, not just an action story. It's on a very big scale. And the emotions are grand, and the adventures are large, and the struggle is enormous. Long John's battle to find the map is something totally consuming. And I find it absolutely enchanting.